And now we're going to learn how to change accounting systems with a company that has accounts receivable and accounts payable. So how do we deal with setting up receivables and payables? Well, if we can imagine we had the same trial balance that we had in the previous video, and the only difference is that we added accounts receivable and accounts payable. You cannot include the balance of accounts receivable or accounts payable in the main journal entry setup. And that's because accounting programs only allow you to change the balances of these two accounts when you enter individual transactions, not when you make a journal entry. So you must enter them one by one until you finish with exactly 30,000 or exactly what the balance is in accounts receivable and accounts payable. And please understand, the reason accounting programs do that is because they want to make sure that the total balances in the general ledger accounts are equal to the sum net total of the accounts receivable customer records for each individual customer and the accounts payable vendor records for each individual vendor. That's the reason why you must enter accounts receivable and accounts payable transactions first. And when you finish, the results must equal the balance of what they would be in the chart of accounts and the trial balance. So if you make sure that you finish with the correct balance after entering receivable and payable transactions, you will also notice that as you enter these receivable and payable transactions, other accounts will change as well. Let's talk about why that is. First, we'll start with accounts receivable. Your goal when you enter the setup transactions for account receivable is to make sure this report, the open invoice report, is correct to the last detail, and each individual invoice has the correct balance or the same balance that it had in the old system when it begins in the new system. Each individual customer's open invoice should have the same amount in the open balance. Well, how do you accomplish that? Well, the currently relevant transactions that you have to enter in order to get the open invoice report to look exactly the same as it did at the moment you finished the old system was any open invoice as of the date of the transfer, any payments that have been applied as of the transfer date, and of course, any credits that have been applied to the open invoices. So, what you would do is you would enter them one by one, and you would notice that when you finish, if you did it correctly, accounts receivable, the 30,000 here, would be equal to this 30,000 down here, which is the total of the open invoice report. But you will also notice that as you record those accounts receivable transactions, other accounts will change. Usually the other accounts that change will be the service income as you enter those invoices and the cash as you receive payments. So you can imagine that the trial balance would look something like this if you only entered the currently relevant accounts receivable transactions. And of course, it's the same idea for vendors. The unpaid bills report is your target. When you finish entering vendor transactions to set up accounts payable, each individual bill or each individual bill's balance in the unpaid bill report must be the same as it was when you finished in the old system. So, in order to do that, you will enter the payables currently relevant transactions, and they are any unpaid bills that you have as of the transfer date, any bill payments that have been applied to those bills as of the transfer date, as well as any vendor bill credits that have been applied to these specific open bills as of the transfer date. That is what will get each individual bill's balance to be correct, and that is what will get you the total result correctly in the trial balance for the balance of accounts payable. And again, when you record the accounts payable transactions to get the balance of accounts payable to be correct, other accounts are also going to change as you do that. Probably the balance of expenses will go up, and probably the balance of cash will go down a little as you record the accounts payable transactions that are currently relevant. Now, what we're finished with here is the trial balance, not as of the transfer date, because we're not finished. We have the trial balance after the accounts receivable and the accounts payable setup. So the goal is to enter every currently relevant receivable transaction, every currently relevant payable transaction, and then the result is something like what you would see here, an incomplete trial balance, but we call this trial balance the trial balance after the accounts receivable and accounts payable setup. Many of you probably already figured out that the main journal entry we are going to make is simply the difference between the two trial balances. So simply take the trial balance that is your goal to set up, which means the balances should be correct as of the transfer date, and subtract the numbers in the trial balance directly after the accounts receivable and accounts payable setup. And those differences will give you the amounts you need for your main setup journal entry. I'm going to show that to you momentarily, but just to remind you again, if you have any trouble making journal entries, you can take the course called Accounting Journal Entries for Kids, and that will help you understand what we're about to do. You also should know some basic spreadsheets, because that will make calculating the amount of the journal entry much easier. However, you don't have to really know anything. Just watch what I'm about to do in Excel. Now, I'm very hopeful that you remember that these were the original numbers in the first trial balance that I showed you at the beginning of the video. And I hope you remember that these are the numbers from a moment ago after finishing setting up receivables and payables. Now, all you have to do is subtract the two. And even if you've never seen an Excel spreadsheet before, it's perfect for this task. I'm simply going to tell Excel that the money amount of the main journal entry is equal to, well, let's back up a little. Let's say, how much should we adjust cash? Well, the amount we'll adjust cash is equal to the original amount of cash that we actually have to have in the account when we finish, minus the amount that was there left over after the accounts receivable and accounts payable setup. So $21,000 debit is what we would need to put to cash in order to make it the $50,000 balance, so that it's the same balance as of the transfer date. Now, we could do that one by one to each individual number, but luckily Excel comes with this little box here in the corner of the cursor, which is called the fill handle. If you just click there and drag it down, it'll make the corresponding mathematical equation to each of the individual cells. In fact, if you copy it over, you can even get it to do the same formula. I'm just doing a shortcut. Rather than typing in this same formula into every single cell to get the difference of every single account, I simply use the fill handle. Now, these numbers are the numbers that you would use for your main journal entry setup. And after you put in these numbers in one big fat journal entry, the result will be your new system has all the correct numbers after the transfer date. So if you were transferring to QuickBooks Desktop, you would click Company, Make General Journal Entry, and don't worry about this, And then again, you would choose the account name, and then you would put the debit amount, choose the account name, put the credit amount, and so on. And it would all come from these amounts here. You would put the name on the row and put the debit amount, put the name on the row and put the credit amount. If you were using QuickBooks Online, then instead, you would just go to the plus sign in QuickBooks Online and go over to Journal Entry, and you would get a window that basically looks just like the Journal Entry window on the desktop. You would click for the pull-down account, choose the account, put the debit, choose the next account, whichever one it is. Well, you're not allowed to do that one, but choose another account, put the credit, and so on. And again, it would all come from what you see in the Excel spreadsheet for the calculated journal entry amounts.